What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN GameScoop. I'm your host, Damon Hatfield. Joining me this week are Justin Davis.
Scoop.
And Mark Medina.
Whoa, three people? This
we
is the first
trio.
Time.
First We're time. On a MegaCop trio this week. Sam had too much on his plate. He couldn't join us today. I don't know, something about crying over a realm. I don't know. It didn't make any sense to me. Anyway, he can't join us today. So you just got the three of us. We still got a great show for you. Lots to talk about. There's just a really, really surprising development in the in Microsoft's attempt at acquiring Activision Blizzard this week that we got to dive into. Dead Island 2 is a big hit. It's a surprise big hit. After all that time in development, everything turned out okay. Duke Nukem Forever, it is not. But first, Star Wars Jedi Survivor is out today. You probably saw IGN's review earlier this week from Dan Stapleton. He gave it a 9 out of 10. Thought it was amazing. I've been playing a lot of it. Mark, I know you're playing it, and Jess, I know you're playing World of Warcraft. We'll get to your updates in just a minute. I love it, and my first impression is that it just feels enormous, because I've been playing for, I guess, a little bit over a week now, and I've only gotten to, you know, there was a big, long opening segment. It's on Coruscant. That's not a spoiler. Then you go to another planet, and that part is huge, and now I'm just going to the third area now after a full week of playing this game. You know, there's all these planets that you go to, and each planet has an enormous area to explore. There's all these nooks and crannies and, you know, off the beaten path areas to explore. So the game just feels incredibly big. And that's not a criticism at all. I'm really, really enjoying it. It's got its hooks in me. I'm thinking about it when I'm not playing it, which is always a good sign. Mark, what do you think?
No, I think it's good. It's exactly like you're saying. So I'm the senior producer for video on the guides team, and I have secondhand stress over this game because like we have to make videos about like collectibles and all that stuff. And I have somebody who's like really, really good at that stuff, and he loves it. And he's like, I'm cool. This is fine. And I'm like, but have you gotten to like Kobo and seen what those numbers look like? Cause if you open your map, it tells you, and it's a very stressful amount. So, but no, as far as the game goes, we played. How early did you play? Did you play like before the big like day one patch?
Yeah. Yes.
So I did as well, and the game did not run super well. I didn't know if that was stuff we were allowed to talk about, but then Waypoint did their whole review, and they were like this whole thing about how we got the game, it didn't run great, and then I stopped playing because, again, it's in a Waypoint article. I'm allowed to talk about it. Whatever. I stopped playing because that big day one patch, there was that scary moment where they said it could break your save. So I kind of stopped. But now that the day one patch is here, the game runs a lot better, and it didn't break my save. So I'm back in. I just got my mount. So that's how early I am still.
Well, I mean, it's still, you know, several hours in.
It still feels like I've played a lot. Yeah, I'm sure most people did that on their first day.
They should just plan it so that the day one patch is ready 14 days before the game comes out.
Yep.
Right. A day negative 14 patch.
Yep, exactly. Yeah, it is true. I'm playing on PS5. And a week ago, before launch, it was a little rough. Even the splash screen, the respawn logo screen, like stuttered. And then for many of us, the game would crash at the exact same moment in like 5 minutes in. But since the day one patch launched the past couple of nights, it's been running much more smoothly.
I jumped back in and I was like, I bet it's not going to fix that much. And it actually did. It runs a lot smoother.
I have two questions for either of you.
Okay.
One, how is the story? Mm-hmm. We don't need to get into spoiler territory, but like, you know, whatever you feel comfortable sharing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I wanted to mention that, you know, so I'm only so far in, I'm in the first probably quarter of the game. However, on that first main planet, after you, you know, make your way through to like the boss of that planet, there's a story bit there, and the story is really cool, and it feels new, and it's like cooler than anything that was in the sequel movies, because it's new. It's not here's another empire and another rebellion. It's just like a new thing that feels very Star Wars. And it's like, why are the video game stories better than the Star Wars movies these days?
Did you watch or read our review? Dan Stapleton's last line in it is, if they make one more Jedi game, this will be the best Star Wars trilogy in 30 years.
Wow. That's pretty good. That's high praise.
Yeah.
Okay.
What was your second question?
Well, it was around. So I played the original probably. Well, I guess I don't know quite how long it was. My gut check is that I was maybe a third or halfway through it before I bounced off it. And it was mainly because of the combat, and the soulsy feels of it. Not necessarily the difficulty, but like if I'm playing a big, just take me on an adventure game. I really just don't want to think about it that much. I just want to be there to have a good time. And like, you know, and Jedi's combat just sort of like it was making me work a little bit too hard. And I'm curious about like, you know, does it feel more refined? Does it feel the same? And, you know, just kind of curious to get your take on that.
I think feels just as refined, probably more refined, but like it's still going to feel like Dark Souls. But like, I mean, this game's got a difficulty meter. You can, you know, make it where it's like the parry timing is not as strict and just damage and all that stuff. But obviously the big thing that this game has that the original didn't was is stances. So like you start with one lightsaber and then eventually you get, you know, the Darth Maul double blade. And then I'll only say one more. and then eventually, you know, you can break those and he dual wields them. And so you can equip two stances at a time and each of those have their own skill tree. And so you can kind of choose, like I do the double bladed. I think that one is like the most fun to play as. And so you kind of get a little bit of freedom to be like, if you didn't like the original Dark Souls, like just one sword, if that didn't do it for you, I would say jump in and try like the dual wielding and stuff like that. It may completely change how the game feels to you.
Okay. I mean, this is purely an academic, like I just play World of Warcraft now. So none of this is like relevant to me in any specific way, but that's good intel in the event that the game breaks its hold on me. And, first of all, play games on whatever difficulty you want. Feel free to play on easy. But for me, it's not about like being a casual gamer. The game's too hard. It's just more about like the type of experience I'm hoping to have with any given game. And like these types of like big, expansive, I'm just here to have a good time. It's like, I don't really feel like I need to be like challenged or pressed by the combat. Like I'm fine to kind of breeze through it. Whereas other games like, you know, shooters and games like that, like I do kind of like the pressure of like performing at a high skill level.
Yeah, I think I'm having a little bit of an easier go of it this time. And I don't know if it's because Elden Ring made me better at these types of games, or maybe they just tuned it. So maybe it's just a little bit easier of a game. I don't know. I'm just playing on Jedi Knight, the normal difficulty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, same here.
Maybe I'd bop it down to easy then and just breeze through. Have a good old time with the Jedi.
The only enemy that has given me a real challenge so far is the Rancor, the first Rancor.
Oh my gosh.
Like, oh my God.
The first time I fought him, I was like, this is impossible.
Because he can grab you. He basically eats you with a one hit kill if he grabs you.
Yeah. That's what they do.
I mean, that's Rancor is going to Rancor.
Yeah. The first time I fought him, I was like, this isn't going to happen. And I want to say the ninth time I fought him is when I beat him. You start to, you know, you get in that Dark Souls mood where you're like, okay, I can't just throw myself at him. I need to get a couple hits and then I need to actually look at what he's doing so I can tell, you know, telegraph those moves. But yeah, he sucks.
Well, here's what you do. You get a bone or something and you lodge it into his mouth.
I forgot that Return of the Jedi was actually a walkthrough to this game.
And then you taunt the poor sad Rancor keeper.
Yeah. Anyway, Star Wars Jedi Survivor is out now. I know there's having a lot of issues on PC. Bad news for PC players, but I'm playing on PS5 and everything's going well. I loved the first game and, leading up to launch and after our preview coverage, everything seemed to be pointing to this one's just going to be bigger and better. And that's been my experience so far. So that's what I'm going to be doing for the next several weeks until, you know, other games like Zelda and Diablo 4 and Final Fantasy 16 comes out.
Mm-hmm. It's next gen only, right?
It is next gen only, and it feels next gen. Like, you know, that opening area on Coruscant. Of course, Coruscant it has flying cars everywhere, and you can see like they're all over. There's the density of the flying cars is impressive, and wait, you can see them way off into the distance. Even if it's just a skybox, it looks really, really cool.
Cool.
I love it. Having a great time. Let's move on to biggest surprising news of this week. The Competition and Markets Authority in the UK has blocked Xbox's Activision Blizzard deal. And this comes after, you know, for several weeks, everything was pointing towards them giving it a pass.
Yeah, it seemed fine.
I know. Everything, all of the sort of speculation and insider intel seemed to be pointing that this thing was going to go through. I think all along, ever since, whatever, over a year and a half ago, when Microsoft announced its intentions to acquire Activision Blizzard. Biggest tech, it would be the biggest tech acquisition in history. And I think all along, most people thought that this would probably go through. Mm-hmm. I think maybe now, the scales have tipped in the opposite direction. I think now it's probably more likely that this deal will not go through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean,
gotten the no-go in the UK, and they have a court battle ahead of them with the FTC here in the United States.
Yeah. You know, I'm not a lawyer, but which, by the way, it's always like anytime you start a statement with like, well, I'm not a lawyer, like you're always on like solid footing. But, you know, no UK agency can stop two US companies from doing whatever they want to do. Right. But like, so they can't stop it, but they can make it like they can't do business in the UK. They can make it so painful for them to try to exist in the UK or just say, okay, fine. Like you don't have access to our, you know, however many millions of gamers that there are now that, you know, that they could put the screws to them that like, you know, either it kills the deal or they have to, you know, carve out some kind of exception for the UK where, you know, Game Pass maybe functions in a different way or there's different provisions for, you know, for that region than there are in the rest of the world, for areas of the world that don't object or don't put up similar, you know, similar blockers. So, mm-hmm. you know, but I do, you know, it is interesting that they, you know, they can't like literally put a stop to it.
Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to imagine a world where they're like, sorry, you know, everyone in the UK, you guys just don't get to play Call of Duty anymore. No, that's so wild.
That's a completely realistic outcome here, mm-hmm. is that like maybe they merge anyway. It wouldn't be you can't play Call of Duty anymore, but it might be like Game Pass is different in the UK than right. it is in the US or elsewhere in the world.
It was weird because I kind of saw it like the whole Elon buying Twitter thing where it was like, is it going to happen? It's not going to happen. Yeah. It was like every day something was different. And then eventually it was just like, okay, it's happening. He owns it. And that's that. And that's how I thought this was going to be. It was like, there's so many ups and downs. And then I thought it was eventually just going to be like, okay, they did it. And it was the opposite. They're like, okay, it didn't do it. And of course they get to appeal it. But the rumblings I'm seeing is that appealing a CMA decision is like almost like never going to, like they almost never.
I've read that too. And I also, the caveat is I don't know what I'm talking about, which by the way, that's just like a blanket caveat. Anytime I open my mouth and say anything, you can just assume like, well, you know, Justin's doing his best. But just some common sense would seem to indicate that like if one regulatory agency shoots something down, maybe it gives the FTC or another group that's sort of looking at this some cover and some momentum to make a ruling or, you know, shift things in a different direction where, you know, or if one group was whoever's the first mover can kind of set the tone for what's to come. And again, with the caveat being like, maybe the FTC doesn't give shit, like maybe they don't look at that or consider that at all. Right. But like, you know, I don't know, that would be a common sense viewpoint, a way to think about this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Microsoft, you know, it says that they plan to appeal, but as Mark was saying, the reason that, appeal is unlikely, to reverse their decision, is according to analyst Piers Harding Rolls speaking to gamesindustry.biz, for Microsoft to be successful in their appeal, the UK's Competition Appeal Tribunal will need to find a procedural error in the CMA's review process or prove that the CMA acted irrationally. So it's like, how likely is that?
Right.
To happen,
you know? So it's basically, yeah. So they don't, it almost sounds like they're not allowing to present any new evidence. They have to just prove that the CMA made the wrong decision, which,
yeah.
That yeah, good sounds luck. Weird. They also, yeah. it was like cloud gaming is what they cited. That would yeah, make it like not.
That's what I was wondering if you were going to touch on that, Damon. We're like, yes, for sure. I don't care whether these companies merge or not. Like I'm interested in it from like a corporate drama standpoint, but like as a gamer, less competition and consolidated ownership is bad for gamers. But on a personal level, I own every console, so whatever. Like, but like the rationale of like, what it would hinder competition in the cloud gaming space. Like that does strike me as irrational. It makes no sense. Yeah. It's like, what are you even talking about? Like what does Activision have to do with cloud gaming that would enhance Microsoft's position in it? I don't actually think that Microsoft is a leader in cloud gaming right now. And they're actually, I would say behind what companies like Amazon and certainly like Google, like, you know, Stadia did not work out, but they were streets ahead of what Microsoft was trying to do from a cloud gaming perspective. So, you know,
Stadia's business model was bad, but their tech was
super good.
Yeah. So like it makes absolutely no sense to me. It makes no sense to me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All along the debate was about Call of Duty and whether or not Microsoft would try to make it exclusive. But yeah, cloud gaming is such a small part of the industry today. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a small part for a long time. It will be a very long time until a significant portion of gaming is done completely via the cloud.
I think so too. And it's like, look, is that the way things are going? Like, maybe, right? Like, on a long enough time frame, yeah, maybe that's what a lot of technology is going to look like, right? But like, the sort of latency required for like any high-end serious hardcore gaming precludes, like, you know, it's like, it's just going to be really tough. It's different. Like, it's different than like streaming media and streaming music, right? It's not the same. And so I don't know, super weird call on that, in my opinion.
Yep. Super weird call. Very surprising news this week, but I, you know, like I said, I do think it makes the end game of the acquisition being approved and going through. I think it makes it less likely than ever right now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Of course, Microsoft says they're going to appeal. We'll see how that goes. And then the FTC is taking them to court later on this year.
I bet you anything they're going to do something like split out, like, you know, they're going to buy all of Activision except for their UK operations, and UK Activision games will be distributed by, you know, they'll sell those rights to, like, you know, EA or someone else, you know.
Interesting.
And then they'll still close the deal. But
yeah, I think what you're predicting with Game Pass is like, because, you know, it's like every region has their own versions of like Netflix and all that stuff. And so it's like on Game Pass in the UK, you can't play Diablo 4, right? Like, that's, I could see them making that like call.
Yeah.
Yep. In any case, this is something we'll have to continue following. We will never be free of the grip of following this story.
Awesome.
Dead Island 2 sold over 1 million copies in 3 days, and that wouldn't be significant for, you know, most other, you know, third party big AAA zombie game release. I think it's significant here because, you know, this game was announced in 2014.
Wow.
Almost 10 years ago. We previewed it at E3 that year in 2014. But then it was delayed into 2016. 2016 came and went. The game never came out. It was on our list of missing games of E3 2017 and 2018. It was just like this game just disappeared. And then we, you know, it sort of resurfaced. I think it just resurfaced last year in 2022. We learned that it had switched hands of developers more than once. They completely rebuilt it from the ground up. They finally gave it a release date in April of this year. And then it actually miraculously came out and was good. We gave it a 7 and now it's a big hit. What? It's like, what a comeback from the dead story.
Yeah, it doesn't happen often. I think of, like you mentioned, Duke Nukem Forever, which that game just, you know, that game looked like a Nintendo 64 game when it was first shown. And then, you know, was awful. And then the only other thing I can think of is like The Last Guardian, which Last Guardian wasn't like a failure, but it just wasn't great, you know. But it was like this game, I was playing it when I first got it, I was playing on PC, and it's gorgeous. It's also next gen only. And I'm like, this game is so pretty. I'm just shocked, because normally it's like, oh, it's, you know, we built the game in, you know, let's say 2018, 2019. So it's like now it's out, but it's going to have graphics from a few years ago. And it's like, no, this game is like absolutely gorgeous. And it's, I think it's really fun to play.
Yeah. You've been playing it, Mark?
I think it's really fun.
Oh, wow. Wow. Yeah. I guess I need to check it out because I hear the gore effects are like next level. And you guys, you know me, you know, I like more gore games than movies.
Well, and the thing is like this game is just built around like every zombie, you know, every weapon is good against like a different zombie part, right? And so it's like the zombies are meant to be just kind of like torn apart. And then this game's like, it's also really big on like elemental stuff. So it's like, you know, there's that pool back there. What you could try to do is you could try to kite all of those zombies and you get like bait and stuff like that. And you can try to bait them to go into the pool and then throw like a battery in the pool and like electrify them all and stuff like that. Like the game, because this game's not as open world as the first one was. This one is more linear. Like it kind of guides you on where to go. Mm. And they're constantly setting up situations where it's like, hey, look, there's some zombies eating a guy and a jerry can full of gasoline. So you'll just like throw it at them, or you can like do a trail and then light that trail on fire and just watch them like burn. It's awesome. I love it.
Yeah, this game was not on my radar. I wasn't a fan of the first game, but now I guess I need to find some time to play this at some point.
Yeah.
I think the setting is very fun. It's very bright. It's just an interesting juxtaposition of like really idyllic, you know, kind of beautiful luxury houses and condos and stuff, and then just zombie smashing.
The second game I played this week that takes place in LA. Well, this one's LA, but LA in general. The other one was the Horizon DLC. So been in LA for a while.
How is that? I think it's interesting that that game, there's like, I feel like there's no buzz about that game. And I loved Horizon Forbidden West.
There isn't. It rules. I love it. I love the Burning Shores story more than I like the original story. It's also incredibly short. If you really wanted to go for it, you could finish it in like an evening. It's like five missions.
Oh, wow.
There's like more to do. There's side missions and stuff like that. But if you want to mainline it, you could probably beat it in like, I don't know, 5 hours or less. I love it. I thought it was really, really good. And the music's super good.
I mean, the music was good in Forbidden West, too.
Yeah.
I'll definitely play that at some point. And Justin, I'm sorry. I meant to allow you to provide an update on World of Warcraft.
Oh, yeah. Well, I have one more thing about Dead Island first. And then, yes, I am happy to give people an update on
another game that takes place in L.A.
Yeah.
World of Warcraft.
Yeah, it's true. It does if you live in L.A. Dead Island, sorry. I was so pumped to tell you about my druid. Just that people talk about these games that are, you know, super delayed and become, you know, vaporware. Like, it's often sort of like, what are they doing? Like, they're screwing up. Like, you know, the fans are so mad. But they don't, the people that are making these decisions to delay or cancel projects have information that we don't have, right? And so, like, the example that like this finally came out and finally turned out good, like, I don't know, just like kudos to them, right? Like, they didn't pull the trigger on it. Like, they were clearly seeing something that's like, this project is off track. This project isn't working. It comes up a lot with like Star Wars, like what's going on with Star Wars? They've canceled these like five or eight movies. Like, you know, like Lucasfilm sucks now. And it's like, well, no, but like, maybe every single one of those product cancellations is them like saving Star Wars, right? Like, you don't know what's going on. Like, those are products that maybe shouldn't have been made and shouldn't come out. So, you know, just the decision to stay the course, like, it's just interesting to see it proven to be the right one this time.
I'm just glad. I'm not that I care about game sales, because I don't, but like, I'm glad that so many people are picking it up, because it's a weird time right now, because you mentioned like Burning Shores, that it's just getting no buzz. And it's like, this is like one of the busiest fall spring seasons we've had in a long time, I think. And it's hard, right? It was like, it's like Jedi. What was before? Resident Evil 4. I was like, I knew there was something. Jedi. And then it'll be Zelda. Then Diablo. And then Street Fighter. And then Final Fantasy 16. But mixed in there is the Burning Shores DLC, Dead Island, and Redfall. And it's like, there's all these games that you can see them getting added to everybody's backlogs.
I do want to say it's kind of a weird time. It's a weird year so far for Sony, because they put out PSVR 2.
Yeah.
That landed with the ka-thunk.
Yep.
And which, you know, the tech is good. That's supposed to be very good tech. It just, I don't think there was any buzz for that. There's no hype or buzz for, Burning Shores, right?
Right.
But they just, you know, put out their report. They just had their best Q4 in PlayStation history. They've sold over 38 million PS5s now. Like, they're doing
Forspoken. It's carrying.
Yes, it is. That's just another example. They're like, their business is doing gangbusters, but their big hardware release and their big expansion, one of their big first party games last year, have a muted reception, I think.
And they just put out some sort of report today. I didn't look too much into it, but it was basically that Spider-Man is their only AAA game coming out in the 2023 fiscal year. And people are not loving that, for one, because that's unlike them to only have one first party game in a whole year. But also, people are like, why are they saying fiscal? Because fiscal could go into March. That's a little terrifying. I think it'll hit this year, but we'll see.
They've said before, you know, they've recently they've reiterated it's coming 2023.
And that game's going to be a monster, to be fair. Maybe you only need one if it's that size.
That's true.
I'm there.
All right, Justin, go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Bite the Druid is
level... Bite?
Yeah, well, her name is Bite.
Her name is Bite. Apologies.
And as a druid, obviously, as you know, she can turn into a bear or a cat or a bird. Or there's like a swimming form, too. And,
or a moonkin.
Yeah, I actually am playing Boomkin. I'm playing a balanced druid, which uses the power of the moon and sun to rain down magic upon her enemies, or really anyone that's in the area. she is level 58, and the actual level cap of the game is 70. But for me, like my character is like her level cap is going to be 60, so her adventure is almost done because 60 to 70, those 10 levels are reserved from the new expansion, and I'm not playing the new expansion. I'm just going through kind of like retro content that I have an affinity for. So she's going through a bunch of quests, infiltrating the Blood Sail Buccaneers right now, and having just a grand old time. And nice. Once she hits level 60, then I'm going to start leveling up Fighty the Monk. And Fighty is a Pandaren monk and is going to level through Mists of Pandaria, and you know, and then we'll get Fighty to level 60, and then we'll see what's that. So I won't go into like the long spiel, but for people that the 2-sentence version is that they changed leveling in WoW so that you know, all the content scales with you, and so you can finally, for the first time ever, go back through and experience old expansions without just like out leveling everything. You can still, like, all the enemies and mobs and dungeons and stuff keep pace with how strong you are. And so if you're someone that just wants to chill out and quest through the game at your own pace, like, it's perfect for that now. So I've always been the kind of player that when everyone else, like, the new expansion is supposed to be great, by the way, and like, you know, maybe I should be playing it, but when everyone's doing that, I'm just like fishing, just like I'm off doing my own thing. And that's the way I've always played MMOs. And so, you know, like, we'll see how long it lasts. But so far, it's going great.
The new expansion is cool, but it's that thing that World of Warcraft has been doing for a while now, which is like, it just doesn't feel like you fight a lot. It feels like you're just like getting a quest and you're just running to somebody else to tell them. And then they're like, cool, now go tell this guy. And that's all you're doing.
Yeah.
And I don't really like the new class either, the Drakthyr. I don't find them fun at all.
But maybe that questing is better than like, hey, go kill 30 of those ogres.
No, I like that. That's what I miss. Man, I miss like Grizzly Hills and they're like, go find 30 bears. And I'm like, hell yeah. Because then you get to, I don't know, then you get to play the game instead of just running and talking to people.
I guess it was more the 30, not the go kill. Like, there needs to be a middle ground.
Mm-hmm.
Go kill some of them.
Oh my gosh.
You know what? How about this? You go kill the amount that you feel comfortable with.
Once you feel like you've had enough. Slain enough.
You feel sated, then return.
Yeah, the balance is, oh man, back in the day in vanilla, you'd go to Stranglethorn Vale and they'd be like, it's a very infamous quest where it's like you need to get like, it's like 20 troll ears. Yep. Okay, well, let's do the math here. Theoretically, that should be 10 trolls. It's not. It's like 100 because the drop rate is awful. And I'm like, what? Shouldn't every troll drop 2? 1, maybe if they're battle scarred, but not 100.
I have a theory about drop rates where, like, really, really high drop rates, like if something drops every time or 60% of the time, like, those drop rates are fine. And ultra low drop rates, like if there's some rare mount or rare loot that drops like 1% of the time, that's fine. Cause it's like, oh, it's like a spec, like, wow, I got it. But it's that middle, like if something has like a 10% drop rate, that is the one that's the pits. Cause like, it's not that statistically unlikely that like 10% drop rate, you could kill something 30 times and not get it.
There's still a good chance you'll kill that many and not even get one. Yeah,
and exactly, and like those are the ones that are just Stranglethorn Vale. They've got those fucking gorillas,
dude.
Oh,
everyone has PTSD about Stranglethorn Vale. It's a tough zone back in the day for us hardened veterans.
Yep.
All right, and before this becomes a Warcraft scoop, Justin, I understand there are some hot new items in the IGN store.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for the reminder. Yes, we have. I'm actually, this is not even a plug. I'm just like genuinely excited that we have Tears of the Kingdom merch in the IGN store now. We have a bunch of t-shirts. They're really cool. If you've never bought a t-shirt from the IGN store, they're actually really soft and nice, wearing high quality. I don't, you know, Damon, not to put you on the spot, I think the one you're wearing is from the store. That's a design we carry. I don't know if you bought it from us. And
I think it is from the store.
So, but I set this up ahead of time, actually, to talk about it on the show. If you go to store.ign.com and buy any Zelda shirts, if you put in code SCOOP at checkout, your Zelda shirts will be 10% off.
That's the podcast we're on.
And what a coincidence.
There is a GameScoop shirt as well, so.
Yeah, but they're not part of the sale. But yes, pick it up.
That's the only one. I mean,
but maybe I can change it. No. I just when I set up the sale in the back end, I said it was Zelda tees.
Your idea was to do the Zelda shirts.
I'll add. That's great. See, now it's putting me on the spot. I'll add the GameScoop shirts to the sale.
Go buy a GameScoop.
You heard it here first.
Go buy a Scoop shirt and type in the promo code Zelda, and you're good to go.
It's store.ign.com, officially licensed Ultra Soft Tears of the Kingdom t-shirts. They look really cool. I want to buy them.
Can we get your Ziff Davis sweatshirt in the IGN store?
Oh, I am wearing a Ziff Davis sweatshirt today. Mm-hmm. No.
Everyone's like, what's Ziff Davis?
Hey, there it is right there.
There's the t-shirts if you're watching the video version of the show.
Yep.
Yeah.
I was in the Slack yesterday when you showed them. So my favorite, hold on, scroll back up, Marian. I think my favorite, thank you. I think my favorite is the fourth one there, the white one.
Oh, that's been the best seller so far.
Yeah, that one's great. But I also like the second one.
Yeah, the little cryptid hand. Mm-hmm. I'm a fan of that one as well.
That one's cool. I like the color. Very Tears of the Kingdom-y.
Yep.
Right. Some news this week that was interesting to me and maybe very, very few other people. Maybe Justin. Justin, do you remember Might and Magic Clash of Heroes?
Yeah. Yeah, of course. Coming that was Capybara.
Yeah, it is Capybara. It was a DS game from 2009. Then they brought it to Xbox Live and Arcade and PlayStation Network in an HD version in 2011. It's a fantastic puzzle strategy RPG with a great art style. And now the definitive edition is coming out this summer. Coming to Switch, PS4, and PC. I don't know why it's not coming to Xbox. It's on Xbox Live Arcade, but that's what they're doing. Dotemu is the one that's publishing it. And yeah, it's Capybara, the Grindstone, Super Time Force, Swords and Sorcery, Critter Crunch. Very cool. Oh, and Below. Everyone remember Below? That was a game that was a long time coming.
Yeah, I'm looking at their Wikipedia now. They've not released a game since Grindstone, so with any luck, fingers crossed. Although Grindstone, they do keep patching it and adding new stuff to it, to be fair. But like, fingers crossed, there's a new Cappy game on the way soon.
Yeah. And well, this game, Might and Magic Clash of Heroes, is fantastic. Its connection to Might and Magic is not important. I don't know anything about that. It's just a really, really good puzzle strategy game. You like stuff like Puzzle Quest. It's more about like positioning your forces on the battlefield and aligning, you know, different units have different colors, and then the enemy units are at the top of the screen. So it's great. I love it. I look forward to playing it again. I haven't played it in years.
That's awesome.
Let's check in with the listeners.
Hey, listeners.
Listeners, remember you can always reach us at the email address gamescoop@ign.com, just like Adam from Boston did. And Adam says, I have a pressing question for the only video game podcast. I have a birthday coming up. I'm thinking about getting a Steam Deck or a Switch. I know I'm late to the party. If you could only get one, which one would you recommend today? It's an interesting question.
It is an interesting question.
Because, I mean, so obviously, Switch is great. You got a new Zelda coming out. But the Switch is also old at this point.
That's what I was going to say. It's like, look, the Switch has some of the greatest video games ever made that are exclusive to that platform. So look, like, if you buy one, you're going to love it. Play Mario, play Zelda. But I'm steamed, Damon. Steamed! That the Switch, it's over 6 years old. So not only is it old, it has never had a price drop ever. That console is still $300. That's the same price that it was 6 years ago when it was brand new. That's crazy.
Yeah.
It's got an OLED screen now.
But yeah, but the OLED one's more.
Oh, yeah. I think it's like 350.
So
also, it never leaves the dock. So what do I care? It's not any more powerful.
So for me, my answer, just from a bang for your buck standpoint, is I would say get the Steam Deck. It's tough. It's awkward to recommend buying a Switch to someone in 2023, I think.
Yeah, especially since all signs seem to point that a new hardware announcement is coming this year, I think.
I mean, but even if there weren't signs, I could just this passage of time tells us that there has to be a console announcement coming sometime.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mark, yeah. Damon, what say you?
Look at Damon playing a Steam Deck. Everyone in the comments is going to be like, I just emulate my Switch on a Steam Deck. But We're going to pretend that that's not real. I would say Steam Deck. It's like the Switch can play certain games that no other console can play, like Zelda, right? And it's like, so you have this like list of games that are exclusive to that console. But then if you go to the Steam Deck can play every other game that's not part of that Nintendo list, right? And yeah. So it's like, it's really hard not to recommend the Steam Deck. Plus, for me, if he's looking for a handheld, that's the thing, is like, for me, is like Steam Deck is way more comfortable just because it's bigger and I have bigger hands. I love the Steam Deck. I think it's really, really cool. And, you know, Switch games are expensive. Even they get put on the eShop store and they're insanely expensive, where Steam sales, you can get new games sometimes for super cheap. But for the most part, if it's an indie game that you haven't, I don't know what the sales are, but let's say it's like, oh, I want to play Celeste. I'm sure that game's like a few bucks, right? Yeah, like where on Switch, it would be like $20 or $30.
It's true. Yeah. It's a good point. It is worth pointing out, you touched on this, Mark, that the Steam Deck is a beefy boy. So, yes. You know, you have to decide for yourself whether that's a pro or con. That's actually the reason I passed on one, although I've been being worn down over the months, but like, it's a little heavy and a little bit thick for me for a portable game console. But, you know, Damon, I've always said that some people like them thick.
That's true.
I got one right here, and it is enormous. I have big hands, and it makes my hands look small.
Yeah, it looks big. It looks big in your hands.
This thing is huge, but I love it. Hey, look, there's me.
Oh. Got a cool reflection there. So I think that's our recommendation, Adam. You're not going to, you know, you're not going to hate your Switch if you get it, but I just think it's getting a little bit long in the tooth. New hardware for that is coming. Yeah. Steam Deck is a little bit new and exciting. I actually have yet to get a Steam Deck myself, but I really do want one. I don't know if I'll wait for the sort of a revised model for that or not.
Well, and in a desperate situation, if it's like the Switch can be docked, so can the Steam Deck. You're playing games at like, you know, 800p on your TV, but I mean, you're doing that with a Switch, so.
True. Okay, well, my wife and I are leaving immediately after this to go to a wedding. I'm actually wearing my tuxedo pants right now, and I can hear my wife walking around upstairs in her heels, which tells me that she's almost ready. Oh. So let's move right into video game 20 questions right now. We make sure we have time for that. Our suggestion this week comes from Ledsky from Seattle. And I hope this is okay to share. Ledsky included this in the body of their email. Ledsky is the principal design director for Minecraft.
Whoa. Oh. That's a really cool job. Yep. Minecraft is in such a good place. I love, like, my girls are both really into it. And, like, seeing that game through the lens of, you know, an 8-year-old is awesome these days.
He says, "Hey, Omega Cops, I'm a huge fan of the show. Watch it every week. The show is a big highlight of the week, and I never miss it." Thank you for tuning in. And with that, let the questioning begin.
Hey, Mark, don't screw this up for me.
I thought about it. I was like, oh, man, it's just two people? That's weird.
You're down. Yeah,
it's
you're
a
down.
Total. I do not carry this game one bit, so that was a total joke.
Obviously, neither do I. Everyone hates me. So we'll see how this goes.
Okay, did this game come out in the 70s, 80s, or 90s?
No.
Okay, more my element. Okay, so 2000 plus, so we got 23 years of games. Did this game come out, is this game exclusive to one platform?
Yes.
Hey. Okay, so we got to figure out which platform. So,
was this game exclusive to a Nintendo platform?
Yes.
Hey. Maybe Damon's taking it easy on us this week.
Got this. It's Mario. Okay, so is this exclusive to Switch?
No.
Okay. So what do we got? We got, it could be late in 64, GameCube, Wii, Wii U.
Was this exclusive to the Wii?
No. That's five.
Same question, GameCube?
No.
Rip. So it's Wii U or a late Nintendo 64 game.
Or handheld.
Or handheld. Okay.
I mean, we got, it's annoying to do this, Mark, but we should just burn the questions and get the console because we got there so fast.
I'm with you. Okay. So, okay. I super doubt it's Wii U.
What, was this exclusive to the 3DS?
No.
Oh, great. Was it exclusive to the Wii U?
No.
God damn it.
No. So it's got to be, you said 3DS, so it should be DS.
It's got to be DS.
Or late Nintendo 64.
Let's spend, okay. Was this exclusive to the DS?
Yes.
There it is. There we go.
Okay. So exclusive to DS.
Is a main character of this game playable in Smash Brothers?
No. That's 10.
Okay, so probably not.
Could be Tetris DS. We never did get that playable L block.
Or like Brain Age or Nintendogs.
Yeah, okay. So was this game developed or published by Nintendo?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So now you're in the exact right, you know, those
like first party kind of like, but didn't have like characters. So my brain goes to Brain Age or Nintendogs.
Does this game star cute dogs?
No.
Okay. Does it star cute brains? No. okay. Does this game have brain in the title?
I'm not sure if that's a loud question.
Is that not legal? Okay.
I'll say no. Well,
yeah. So we know it's not Brain Age.
I don't know that it's like, I think it's against the gentleman's rules, but.
Shoot. Okay.
We're off to a strong start. I know Damon's got to go. Let's pump the brakes a little bit just to take a sec. Okay. So Nintendo developed or published DS exclusive does not star a character that's playable in Smash Brothers.
Yeah.
Oh,
Advance Wars?
Yeah, that's a really good one. There are no Advance Wars playable characters. Advance Wars tanks. Is actually... Yeah, is there tanks in this game?
Yes.
Oh, do we have it? Okay,
Wait.
Okay, don't answer.
There were two of them on the DS. There was Dual Strike and Days of Ruin.
Oh.
Dual Strike was the first one, the third one that came out in the U.S., and that was the one that maintained the cutesy art style, and Days of Ruin was the one that like rebooted it with like the gritty dark art style.
Thank God you're here. I would have just called it Advance Wars.
No, I just know. I ran an Advance Wars fan site when I was a kid. Like I know it's like one of my favorite games of all time. I don't know why I cut you off though, because it's not like I have like a big question to ask.
Well, we have six questions left, and if we're fairly certain it's going to be one of those two, then how do we narrow it down?
Yeah, that's
because I don't know anything about those games.
Okay, I mean, so Damon, did this game have like a gritty, more adult sort of dark art style?
No, that's 15.
Okay,
last question? Was this one of those? Okay, sorry, Mark.
No, I want to narrow it down because I want to get it because my last couple times have not been successful.
Is this game in the Advance Wars franchise?
Yes.
Is this Advance Wars Dual Strike?
Yes, it is.
Hey.
We only need two people.
Yep, Advance Wars Dual Strike. It's one of the good ones. You're a fan of this one as well, Justin?
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, I feel like this is an underrated Advance Wars game. Like, but maybe it's properly rated because I think it's well liked. But like, yeah, this game was great.
I wasn't sure what to do if you asked me though if Nintendo developed this game.
I mean, Intelligent Systems,
which they're independent, right? Even though they mostly work for Nintendo.
No, they're a first party studio, aren't they?
I mean, their website doesn't say anything. There's like no Nintendo logo on it.
I'm looking it up.
They've made games for like without Nintendo.
I thought that they were a first party developer. Nope, you are right.
Yeah,
video game developer best known for developing games published by Nintendo. Mm-hmm. Fire Emblem, Paper Mario, WarioWare.
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah, it's me. I always think of it as a first party game, but no. Advanced Wars Dual Strike. Mark, you haven't played this one?
No, I've never played any Advance Wars. Oh, I just was like, I don't know, just popped in my brain, probably because the other one's like so fresh. And it's funny because I didn't even know these were on DS because Advance Wars obviously is like Game Boy Advance, but I don't know if that's where it gets its name from or not. But
so, David, here's a fact for you. Intelligent Systems, according to their wiki page, has never released a game on a non-Nintendo platform.
Wow.
Interesting.
So Fire Emblem Heroes on mobile, is it?
Mm. Okay. They did that one. Interesting.
But not all the games are published by Nintendo, like Cubivore, that was published by Atlas, but like only came to Nintendo platforms.
Interesting. Yeah, very, very closely aligned with Nintendo, but not actually outright owned by Nintendo.
This was in that era of, like, they were trying to do puns in their game titles, like Dual Strike is DS.
Everything was DS.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yeah.
What was the Ninja Gaiden one? Dragon Sword?
Something like yeah.
Anyway, nicely job. Thank you for the suggestion, Ledsky from Seattle. Viewers, listeners, if you have your own suggestions for Video Game 20 questions, email them to me at the email address gamescoop@ign.com. And that is all the scoops that we have for you this week. Thank you. Sorry for the truncated episode, but we're recording late on a Friday afternoon. It's late. It's evening now for where Justin is, and I'm going to a Fancy Pants wedding in downtown LA right now. So with that said, thank you to both Mark and Justin. Thank you to Marian working behind the scenes to make this episode possible. My name is Damon Zeichen, Gamescoop, and we're out. I said Gamescope, but this is Gamescoop.